The most important operations in linear algebra are adding things and rescaling things, or more generally, taking linear combinations. Now, we've seen how to take linear combinations of rows. You can add a row to another row or rescale it. Or you can take linear combinations of columns or of matrices or lots of other things, and we have a name for a set where you can do this sort of thing. We call it a vector space. So a vector space is any set where you're allowed to add two different elements, and you're allowed to rescale elements, and if you can add things and rescale things, that means you can take linear combinations. And we want the usual rules of arithmetic to work. Now, I'm not going to write down all of the usual rules of arithmetic, but they're things like that if you doesn't matter what order you add things in, x plus y is the same thing as y plus x, or you have the distributive law, that a constant times x plus y is a constant times x plus the constant times y. There are eight axioms. Don't get hung up over the axioms. The point is you're allowed to add things, you're allowed to rescale things, you're allowed to take linear combinations, and everything you learned in elementary school about arithmetic still works. Okay. Now, being a vector has nothing to do with length or direction. You know, we're probably taught in middle school, a vector is something that has a length and a direction. Wrong. Vectors are things that you can add and rescale and take linear combinations of. So, for example, let's consider functions. We'll have functions on an interval. Whenever we see C parentheses some set, it means functions of that set. And continuous functions. So we have continuous functions on the interval 0 to 1. Well, does it make sense to add two functions? Sure. Can you multiply function by constant? Sure. Do the usual rules of arithmetic work? Sure. That's a vector space. Now, what's the length of the function sine of x? What's the direction of x squared plus 2x minus 7? It's not length and direction, but it's being able to take linear combinations and everything works. Next example is a pair of numbers. In general, we'll write as Rn, n tuples of numbers, so R2 is pairs of numbers. You know, an object is just two numbers, one written on top of one another, a column, and the way you add them is you add the first number, you add the second number, and you do scalar multiplication. And you've probably seen this example 100 times. Okay, our next example is arrows in the plane. So let's suppose we have a blank sheet of paper. We've got a point that we're going to call the origin. And we're just going to consider all arrows whose tail is at the origin. And our rule for adding two arrows is the parallelogram law. If you call this U and call this V, you make it into a parallelogram, and the arrow that starts at the origin and goes to the opposite side, that's called U plus V. And how do you rescale things? Well, you just head off in the same direction. You go twice as far to get 2U. You get go the same distance in the opposite direction to get minus U. You can go minus root 2U, whatever. So this set of all arrows, you can check that the rules of arithmetic work. Takes a little bit of geometry, but they do. And that's another example of a vector space. Now, you might say, yeah, but isn't R2 the plane? Didn't we just do this example? Well, not quite. R2 is pairs of numbers. These are arrows. An arrow isn't a pair of numbers. But from a pair of numbers, you can get an arrow. If I give you a pair of numbers, you can come up with an arrow that goes x1 steps to the right and x2 steps up. Or to put another way, if you pick these two special vectors, let's call it I, which is one step to the right, and j, which is one step up, you can write any arrow as some multiple of I plus some multiple of j. So that gives you a correspondence between pairs of numbers and arrows. And this correspondence respects the laws of addition, and it respects the laws of scalar multiplication. So for all intents and purposes, R2 and our plane P look the same. They behave the same. And we call them isomorphic. Okay. The next thing we want to know about vector spaces is how big they are. If something is isomorphic to Rn, we say it's n-dimensional. N-dimensional real vector space. So our plane P was two-dimensional because we could describe arrows with two numbers. In other words, with an element of R2. How about the set of all quadratic polynomials in a variable t? Well, this you can describe with three numbers. A quadratic polynomial is something of the form a constant plus another constant times t plus another constant times t squared. And how, the polynomial itself, it's a function. It's a machine that eats numbers and spits out numbers. You could graph it and you'll get a parabola. But you can keep track of it by just keeping track of those three numbers. So this space of quadratic polynomials, which we'll write as R lower 2, the lower 2 means up to second order, is isomorphic to the set of all three tuples of numbers. How do you add two polynomials? You add the coefficients. How do you rescale a polynomial? You rescale the coefficients. So that means it's a three-dimensional vector space. Another example is the space of all 2x2 matrices. Can you add matrices? Sure. Can you multiply them by scalars? Sure. Does arithmetic work? Sure. And this is four-dimensional. And the correspondence is here's an element of R4. Here's an element of M22. An element of R4 is a column with four numbers in it. This is a 2x2 matrix. And it's pretty obvious that to every list of four numbers, you can make a 2x2 matrix and vice versa. And this correspondence respects the rules of the game. Okay. Last thing is we've been talking about real vector spaces. You can also have something called a complex vector space. A complex vector space is just like a real vector space, only when now we say you can multiply it by a scalar. Scalar means complex number. So the simplest example of a complex vector space is Cn. It's all columns made up of n complex numbers, and you add them entry by entry. You can rescale them. That's a complex vector space. Anything that's isomorphic to Cn, we call n-dimensional complex vector space. But it's also a 2n-dimensional real vector space. Anytime you have a complex vector space, if it makes sense to multiply by an arbitrary complex number, it makes sense to multiply by an arbitrary real number because a real number is a special kind of complex number. So every complex vector space is also a real vector space of twice the dimension. Here is Cn. Here is R2n. If you give me 2n real numbers, I can make n complex numbers out of them. So the upshot is vector spaces are our playground. It's where you can add things and multiply by scalars. If you're multiplying by real scalars, it's a real vector space. If you're multiplying by complex scalars, it's a complex vector space. There are lots of different kinds of vector spaces, but they seem to all wind up looking a lot like Rn or Cn. And if something looks like Rn, if it's isomorphic to Rn, we say it's n-dimensional real vector space. And if it looks like Cn, we call it an n-dimensional complex vector space. We'll have a more precise definition of dimension later, but this definition will do for now.